eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
On that riding cloud this morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Good evening. Greetings to you all in the blessed name of our Savior Jesus Christ. This evening we will be continuing with the letter of James from verse 7 onwards till 12. Before we begin this, let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you for this blessed evening that you had gifted to each one of us, Lord. As we begin this Bible study this evening, we pray that you continue to speak to us, continue to minister to us as we have gathered together in your name with the love and with the truth. Lord, we pray that you minister to us through the power of the Holy Spirit this evening. Continue to help us think through it and also to accept all those revelations that you want us to know and also to apply that in our lives. We submit ourselves into the hands, be with us and guide us. In Jesus' most blessed name we pray. Amen. Thank you for all your responses. Continue to engage with the living word and we will continue to learn. This evening we will be dwelling on James chapter 4, verse 7 to 12. This is the passage which speaks about righteousness. The previous passage that we meditated in the last class speaks about something which God accepts and God rejects. We learned that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. And now, from verse 7 onwards, there is a theme which runs through verse 12. from 7 to 12. The theme is righteousness. In the other words, we can call it as fairness, honesty, integrity, or justice. These are some of the themes that run through this passage from 7 to 12. Justice is a common word in the Old Testament. And James actually brings in this particular subject to realign those people who are proud, who were actually quarreling and fighting in the church, who were actually double-minded, and also those who were satisfying their pleasures being Christians. From this verse onwards, he speaks about the justice that they need to have in their lives so that they may be acceptable in the sight of God. It is also called righteousness. Righteousness is very crucial for us. We need to walk through righteousness. We need to seek the righteousness. And that is what is the emphasis here. The act of God in bringing sinners into new covenant relationship with himself through the forgiveness of sin. The emphasis of James was, see, you have sinned already. You are doing what you should not do, and you are sinful in your acts as well as in your thoughts. So now the point that I would like to reveal to you is this, that now seek righteousness, seek justice for yourselves. Because unless you seek righteousness and justice, you cannot come into the covenant again. Yes, the covenant is broken, the relationship with your God is broken because of all that you are doing from verse 1 to 6. Now, do something else. Choose the right path. Come back into the covenant relationship with the God through the forgiveness of sin. Justice is a declarative act of God by which he establishes persons as righteous, that is, in right and true relationship with himself. Justice means that you get along with God in a right way. Injustice means you get on the wrong path in your life. But what James is urging here in this particular passage that we are studying this evening is this, that he wants that those people not just to go away like that, but to know their sin, to confess that sin, and also get that forgiveness from God and come back to the relationship with God. In OT, righteousness has to do with relationship and obligations of that relationship. So James is not just letting out the people who are sinning. He wants them to come back. That is the point here from verse 7. Abraham is the best example in the OT because he was reckoned righteous. He was considered righteous. That is brought into personal relationship by virtue of his response of faith to the covenant offered by God. That we see in Genesis 15:6. Abraham could not justify himself, but on the basis of the covenant, God establishes him as righteous. So that is the point here which James wants to reveal to us this evening. But as we come to the New Testament, it is referred to the consequences of the work of Christ on the cross to save the sinful humanity. The word and work of Christ embedded in the message that Paul proclaimed was a reminder that righteousness or justification is the gift of God through the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross that we see in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20. So this is just the brief introduction about justice in the Old Testament, justice in the New Testament. So in the Old Testament, it is coming back to the relationship, coming back to the covenant with God. And in the new, it is what Jesus has done through his word and the work on the cross for saving humanity. So if you want justice as a New Testament believer or a disciple of Jesus Christ, we need to come back on the track of Jesus Christ. We need to come back and understand what Jesus has done in our lives. Even in the letter of James, chapter 1, 19 to 21, which is actually the core of the letter, the theme of the letter, it says, "Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce righteousness." See here, he's bifurcating, he's dissecting here and telling that, see, if you don't do this, you will not be counted as righteous. If you don't lead your life as it is revealed in the Bible, you will not be counted as righteous. That is why it says, for anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save the souls. My dear people of God, this is what is very, very crucial for us to know. So as the theme is introduced in chapter 1, 19 to 21, James actually, as he concludes the letter from chapter 4 onwards, he brings in that group of people who are acting unrighteous, who are living unrighteous, and he is urging that unrighteous people to see how best they can come back to the relationship, how best they can come back to the relationship and also to the covenant with Jesus Christ. Very crucial, my dear people of God. See, there is a light-hearted understanding about coming back to Jesus Christ. Unless we do the right things, unless we lead a life which actually demonstrates the faith that we have, we will not be counted as righteous in the sight of God, in the sight of Jesus Christ. And the theme, that is James 1, 19 to 21, the theme of the letter, James urges the church to focus on the righteousness of God, on the justice of God for their lives. The righteousness which is offered by Jesus to us needs to be realized by following certain lifestyle as an expression of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. My dear people of God, if there is no lifestyle which is not expressing the faith that you're following, that means that lifestyle is not acceptable in the sight of God. That lifestyle is not called righteous lifestyle. That lifestyle is not called the lifestyle which is emphasizing on justice of God. So James is going in detail of how to accomplish or realize the justice or righteousness that needs to be reflecting in our lives. My dear people of God, this is what is the passage that we are studying this evening. James 4, 7 to 12, we see James speaking about justice which God requires in our lives. It is not the judgment that he's speaking. He's speaking about, he's emphasizing on the word justice. Justice is equivalent to the righteousness, and righteousness in a person will contribute much to the covenant. And justice is upright, righteous relationship which are essential for our spiritual growth. So he needs our undivided attention, because he reveals three things in this passage from 7 to 9, and again from 10 and 11, and in 12th verse he speaks about God, and he concludes this passage urging the group of people, those people who are leading their lives as unrighteous. If you feel that you are unrighteous, if you feel that there is no justice or the presence of justice in your life, and this is the time to learn this passage. This is the time to reflect upon your own lives so that you might be confirmed in your own self that you are in the right track following the guidelines or the instruction or the commands of the covenant with Jesus Christ. It is the section 1, that is from verse 7 to 9. Shall we read this? It says, "Submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Verse 9, be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord and He will exalt you. See, verses from 7 to 10, as we have read from the ESV version of the Bible, speaks about something very crucial. See, this, as I said, is actually focused on those people who have gone astray from the covenant, who have gone astray from Jesus Christ, who have gone astray through their lifestyles, which is not expressing their faith. And to them and to us as the church, He's asking us to do 10 things here in these 3 verses, 7, 8, and 9. In this 7, 8, and 9, 3 verses, we see 10 imperatives, 10 commands, which is to be present in any person following Jesus Christ. If these 10 actions is not present, if these 10 these 10 commands are not practiced intentionally, then it is a time for us to reflect back and see where we need to set ourselves right with our Lord Jesus Christ. So this passage is speaking about the commitment to the justice, commitment to that righteousness. What are those words? What are those commands? What are those imperatives? It is called aorist imperatives in Greek, and we have 10 of that in these 3 verses. See these words in verse 7, submit. And in second part it said resist, draw near, cleanse, purify, be wretched, mourn, weep, gloom, and also humble yourself. My dear people of God, these are some of the crucial words that we see as verbs which needs to be there in our lives, which needs to be practiced intentionally in our lives. Let us go word by word, or let us go in detail of what has been written here. Resist is actually, submit means it's a military term here. It is to subordinate. It is to be subordinate and render obedience to the one who is in authority more than you are. Submit is a military term, as I said. So he urges us to submit to God, who is the authority over our lives, who have saved us, who has given us the grace to come and know the truth through His sacrifice on the cross. And the second word we see is the resist. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. See, all these things is to be practiced intentionally in our faith. It is a lifestyle that has been emphasized here by James. He says, these are essential for your spiritual growth. If you don't submit, it's not going to work properly. If you don't resist, you are going to be in the trap. Meaning, these are some of the responsibilities that are there in the covenant with Jesus. Resisting devil is our duty. Saying no to temptation is our responsibility. Sitting quietly every day in personal prayer is my healthy routine spiritually. It is a spiritual health that we need to be concerned about. If we don't pray every day, it means that we are allowing the spiritual life to become weaker and weaker every day. Eating too much is called gluttony. It might spoil your health. Maintaining healthy lifestyle is my responsibility. Raising up early for a walk, for a morning walk, and honoring the health that God has given to us is my responsibility. God will not come every morning to wake you up and tell, go, get up and go to walk every day. It is my responsibility that I have to accomplish, because see, the covenant is between the two parties, and both the parties has their responsibility. My dear people of God, many times we don't understand what is the agreement between me and my God, where I have to fulfill my responsibility, where God has fulfilled His responsibility towards my life. That is where James is bringing in this particular passage, in which he's calling those people who have gone astray to commit themselves to that justice, to commit themselves to that righteousness. God will not take responsibility for maintaining your diet. It is your responsibility to maintain your diet. Isn't it simple but yet profound? The only way to resist devil is to submit to God 100%. To commit our lives to Him 100%. That is what is expected of us. How does that be accomplished in our lives? By doing these verbs, by accomplishing or by practicing these verbs in our own lives. 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says, "No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and He will not let you to be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, He will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure." See the promise, see the assurance that we have. Paul reveals that to the Corinthian church. You don't need to worry about what the temptation is, because God gives the temptation, only those temptations that you can overcome. And He also gives you another way, a way to escape from the temptation. And here in this verse, it is emphasized that there is the responsibility of a Christian life. There is a responsibility for our own faith. See, the faith has been gifted by God. It is our responsibility to maintain that faith, to nourish that faith, and to move forward. See, the temptations that we encounter, the temptation that comes from the devil can be stopped. That's why he says, resist it. Submit to me and resist the devil, and he will flee from you. That is the promise that we have in this verse. Isn't it very interesting to know this? My dear people of God, 4:8 says, "Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." See, again, this cleanse, purify are two verbs which speaks about ceremonial cleansing. Ceremonial means it is something related to the religion, the tradition, the culture of that particular people group. Cleansing and purifying, even as we come to the table every month, early in the morning, on the dawn service, and also on the first week. What are we doing? We are coming intentionally to cleanse and purify ourselves by remembering what Jesus has done on the cross, and we take that communion and remember what Jesus has done for us on the cross. And it is called the ceremonial cleansing in one way. My dear people of God, this cleanse and purify again is our responsibility. That's why James says, draw near to God and He will draw near to you. Do these things in your life and you will automatically come near to God. When you come near to God, God also will come to you and cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. See these words, cleansing, purifying, and double-minded. My dear people of God, very crucial for us to understand. Who needs the cleansing here? Those who are double-minded. Because a single-minded person is always focused on what to accomplish. But the double-minded will be doing both what God wants, what the world wants. Again, we need to understand those things which we are doing and coming away from the relationship with God. That is why the justice, that is why the righteousness is very, very crucial. What James is urging is work on your righteousness. Work on your righteousness. Work on your responsibility. Work on the justice that needs to be evident in your life. Corrupt hands, unclean hearts, and double-minded. All these three go together. If you are single-minded on God, all your faculties will be holy as God is holy. The problem with James's congregation in Jerusalem church was that they were treating their sin lightly. The word laughter in verse 9. Turn your laughter. Let your laughter be turned to mourning. Meaning the word laughter itself will tell us so much about the Jerusalem church, because what we can assume through this verse is that they were seeing, they were pursuing, or they were understanding the sin very lightly. They did not know what the consequences are. So the word laughter in verse 9 seems to inform us that they were not serious about their sin. In Proverbs 21:15, it says, when justice is done, it is a joy to the righteous, but terror to evildoers. My dear people of God, when justice is done, the joy is for the righteous. When you seek justice, when you seek the kingdom of God, when you seek the way of Jesus Christ, when you want to passionately follow Jesus, it means that you will be intentionally demonstrating these imperatives, practicing these imperatives, these 10 imperatives in your life. Double-minded is very, very dangerous, as we have been exploring from the past classes. It speaks about having forked tongue like the snake. It is used for good as well as for bad. They have two lifestyles, two desires, two masters, two Bibles, two Gospels, more than one church, more than one ministry, more than one allegiance. They can flip any time on any side, divided in your loyalty. My dear people of God, these are some of the characteristics of double-mindedness. And this double-mindedness will lead to unclean hands and unclean hearts. They confidently think they will reach heaven no matter what, because they will be covering everything in that spiritual covering. If they are not loyal to the church, they will cover it with some spiritual covering. If they are not loyal to the gospel, they will cover it with some other doctrine. Conveniently, whatever is available, they will see to it that they will pick out the verses, pick out the passages from the Bible, and they will cover it so that people will see it as holy. But my dear people of God, this is one reason that so many denominations have come into existence today. Don't ever deceive your own self. It is not the other people. Yes, there is deception everywhere. Even in the Christendom, there is a deception. Even in the secular world, there is a deception. But in that deception, God has called us to the light. Darkness is there. But in that darkness, we need to see who is Jesus. They can confidently think they will reach heaven no matter what is going on around them, because they are carefully preparing themselves in the way. They want not what God requires of them. James suggests that it's better to mourn, to be wretched, to weep in verse 9, because James is certain that there will be a day of judgment, as stated in Jeremiah 6:26. It says, Jeremiah 6:26 says, O daughter of my people, put on sackcloth and roll in ashes. Make mourning for as only son. Most bitter lamentation, for suddenly the destroyer will come upon us. My dear people of God, this was the major concern for James. He doesn't want anyone in Jerusalem church to be cast away by the wrath of God. Very crucial, very passionate cry. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands. I cannot cleanse your hands. I cannot purify your heart. I cannot pay for what you have done wrong. You have to do for yourself. I have to do for myself. This is an exercise every day. Am I submitting myself? Am I resisting the devil? Am I drawing near to God? Am I cleansing my hands? Am I purifying my heart? Am I conscious about all these things that is going on around me? Jeremiah 6:26. O daughter of my people, put on sackcloth and roll in ashes. Make mourning as for an only son. Most bitter lamentation, for suddenly the destroyer will come upon us. This is true for each one of us, my dear people of God. We do not know when we will be gone from this world. We are just like a bubble on the water. As we see the circumstances around us, even as we go through this pandemic, where are we going to say that we are going to live for another 10 years? Where are we going to say that we are going to live another 50 years? Uncertainty is looming everywhere. Preparing ourselves in the light of the word is very, very crucial. That's why James is emphasizing on Jeremiah's prophecy. The destroyer will come upon us anytime. Galatians 6:7, Paul reveals that to the church. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whoever, whatever one sows, that will he also reap. My dear people of God, this is the truth about our lives. If you are not serious about our lives, if you are not serious about the righteousness that we need to cultivate in our life, it will become very dangerous for us to lead spiritual life as it is. Oh my beloved in Christ, now is the time to repent and turn back to the one who has given us only one choice, which has been revealed to us through the gospel of Jesus Christ. The choice of Jesus and his teaching and his way and his revelations and his cry and his compassion for all of our lives needs to be understood. The prodigal son understood that very lately after he squandered all that he had. My dear people of God, this is the time for us to understand, to come back to that covenant, come back to that relationship. That is why James is calling those sinners to come back to that relationship so that they might be saved. Mixed motives want both the world and God. And these two desires battle within us. He wants God. We want God on Sundays and the world from Monday to Friday and Saturday. In Greek, double-minded means dualistic. Two ways at one time, spiritual and fleshy, God and evil, world and word. Double-minded person will not receive anything from the Lord. If you insist God to save you being double-minded, then he might give you to that love you have towards the world. But he cannot share himself with you. You will not have him because your allegiance, your mind, which are your choices, are divided. My dear people of God, if you love something of the world, and if you consistently keep on loving something from the world, you know what God does? He just says, you go in the way that you desire. If he seconds the motion, it means that he has left you out of his covenant. Those things should not happen in our lives. This is the time for us to repent and come back to that covenant. This is the time to repent and come back to that relationship. You know why? It is not for God. It is for me. It is for us. It is not for God that we need to come back. God is safe and secure. Some of us will tell, I want God on this subject. I want the world on that subject in my life. The combination of two worlds is very, very dangerous. Once you start doing like this, like that, you are trying to live in two houses. Allegiance, loyalty to two masters. There is only one God, and he says, I won't allow room for competition. My dear people of God, the God whom we worship is jealous God. That's what we saw in verse 5. He yearns jealously over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us. Is he just without purpose has kept that revelation in the scripture? Cleansing and purifying are Old Testament terms for ritual purity and ethical purity. James uses these two words that his congregation can relate to. Come back to God. Come back to God is the urge. Cleanse your hands. Purify your heart, you double-minded, is the call for us, my dear people of God. This is the call, this is the commitment, this is the call for commitment to that justice. Shall we move on to James 4, 9 and 10? Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Yes, there were people, as I said, who are light-hearted about the sin, about the worldly lifestyle in the fellowship, in the church, not giving preference to what God has revealed to them. To them, James is urging to be wretched. Turn your life so that you can be saved. A contrite spirit of confession is essential for God's cleansing. Unless we come in repentance, God is not interested in giving us the forgiveness. Cleansing will not lead us into merriment. Rather, it leads us to reverence towards God. My dear people of God, see to it that these things are present in your life, that these ten commands are present in your life and mine. Section 2 starts from 4, 10 and 11. It speaks about the advantage of that commitment towards righteousness. In verse 10, humble yourself before God and He will exalt you. Humility is the key. Humility is the key for you to come back to that righteousness, come back to that covenant. The way up is the way down. If you want to grow up, you need to come down. The lowly one becomes the lifted one. This is marked advantage to humility, eventually brings honor. Humble yourself before God and He will exalt you. My dear people of God, humility is the key to our lives. Humility was the key to Moses' leadership. Proverbs 3:34 says, towards the scorner he is scornful, but to the humble he gives favor. Luke 1:52, he has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. 1 Peter 5:5-6, likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. Clothe yourself, all of you, with humility toward one another. For God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humble self, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you. My dear people of God, this is the message for all of us, for humility. Yes, we need to become humble. There is no other way. God hates the proud, gives grace to the humble. Do you need grace in your life? Do you need grace in your church? Do you need grace in your family? The key is humility. James 11. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law, and the law and the judge and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. Again, James reiterates that misuse of speech here, or speak evil or to slander others, are not acceptable in the sight of God. Leviticus 19:16 says, do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. See the emphasis here. Don't do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Again, Jeremiah 6:28. They are all stubbornly rebellious, going about with slanderers. They are bronze and iron. All of them act corruptly. The characteristic of speaking evil about others, the characteristic of slandering others, is very dangerous for us. That is why James calls the church to lay the tongue on the altar. Romans 1:30, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to the parents. See the
see the category these slanderers belong to. They will be with the haters of God. They will be with insolent. They will be haughty. They are with the people who are boastful. They are with the people, they are counted with the people who are inventors of evil, disobedient people, and also people who are evil in every way. My dear people of God, we take so lightly to speak on others, isn't it? We speak at their back. We speak so good in front of them. Speaking evil against the other is very, very important in our lives, even as it was important in the life of Jerusalem church. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. See the effect of speaking evil. If he does this sin, he will not be just doing one sin, he will actually be doing a sin against God. Speaks evil against the law. Where does law belong to? To whom does the law belong to? Law belongs to God. He is the one who have formulated this. Therefore, we need to see that speaking evil about others actually have a consequence of you standing against God himself. 2 Corinthians 12:20. For I fear that perhaps when I come, I may find you not as I wish, and that you may find me not as you wish, that perhaps there may be quarreling, jealousy, anger, hostility, slander, gossip, conceit, and disorder. My dear people of God, if we are not careful, if we are not emphasizing on the imperatives that has been listed down in the previous verses, we may easily fall back again into the trap of becoming enemies of God himself, because if you slander, if you gossip, it is directly related to the law. Means you are actually working against the law of God, which means you will stand against God by doing this sin. 1 Peter 2:1. So put away all malice and deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. My dear people of God, it is very crucial for us to understand this. Otherwise, we will be standing against God himself. To slander and judge one another is totally incongruous to humble spirit God desires in our lives. To judge the other person means you are judging God's law itself. Judging other means, others means that you are judging God's law itself. His law is a mandate over all people. No one dares assume a haughty position over the law. Many times we don't think the consequence of what we are doing. Unknowingly, we have stood so many times against God by gossiping and by slandering on others. Isn't it? See the word, see the revelation here. No one dares assume a haughty position over the law. The self-styled judge is jeopardized by the law. The self-styled judge is jeopardized by the law. Only the humble person is honored. Why are you judging others and putting yourself in the risk? Why do you declare yourself self-styled judge? True justice, that is righteousness, is rendered when a disciple subjects himself to God in humility and obedience. True justice is rendered when a believer subjects himself to God in humility and obedience. My dear people of God, very crucial, this second section in this particular passage from 7 to 12. That is 10 and 11 verse is very crucial for us to understand. Humble yourself before the Lord and He will exalt you. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers and sisters. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. See the clarity that we have in verse 12. As we move on to the section 3, he speaks about the author of justice. There is a commitment to justice, there is advantage of this justice, and in verse 12, it is the author of justice. There is only one lawgiver and judge, he who is able to save and destroy. But who are you to judge your neighbor? Who are you to judge your neighbor? There is only one lawgiver and judge, he who is able to save and destroy. Who are you? But who are you to judge your neighbor? We need to understand that there is only one who is above the law. That is the God Almighty, the Triune God. He alone has the right to modify or overrule it. God is the one lawgiver and the judge. Lawgiver is a compound noun in the Greek here in this context. It means to set. It means to place. It means to constitute. It means to lay down. And all these characters can be found in that one God that we have, who is above the law, who has formulated it, who has given it to the church. God not only authored the law, He also administrates the law. He serves both as both the executive and also judicial branches of the divine government. God is the king, He is the judge, He institutes and declares His law. God is the judge, He upholds the and enforces His law. My dear people of God, see, all this is coming out, you know why? Because James wants to tell us, see, that your gossiping is actually leading you into a different, altogether a different realm where you are going and standing against God as His enemy. He upholds and enforces the law. Who are you to judge your neighbor? He is the only one who is able to save and destroy. There is one author of law, one judge over the law, and but one savior from the law's condemnation, isn't it? Jesus was condemned to death because of the law, and He became the savior because there was no sin found in Him. This is a rebuke. This is a serious rebuke to those who are involved in judging others with their haughty attitudes and judgmental actions. My dear people of God, save yourself. Don't try to save the nation. Save yourself, save your family. That should be the focus of the person in faith. Maybe if you are matured and if you are strong, you can come and save a member in your fellowship. But the priority should be to save yourself. The simple sins that we do lead to greater consequences. This is a rebuke to those who are involved in judging others with their haughty attitudes and self-righteous judgmental actions. When you should know all the details about the lawgiver and the judge, when you should know all these details about the lawgiver and the judge, who are you to judge your neighbor? That is why, that is the way James counters those who are indulging in judging others by this rhetorical question. Humble attitude and just actions are essential for spiritual growth. James then went on to show how these qualities of life militate against empty boasting. My dear people of God, don't do what you are not supposed to do, because you do not know where it is leading you. Many of us doesn't know where those things are leading us. Very crucial. We gossip so much. We speak so much. We slander. We judge. You know where it is leading you? This is the verse which reveals that. Luke 6:37, it says, "Judge not, and you will not be judged. Condemn not, and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiving. You know what it means? If you are judging someone, it will lead you to judgment. We need to escape the judgment. That is why we are striving in our faith. We don't have to come under judgment. If you are judging others, you are getting yourself into the judgment. Understand this truth. Judge not and you will not be judged. If you judge, you will be led into judgment. Don't condemn. Condemnation will lead to your condemnation. Condemn not and you will not be condemned. Condemnation will lead to condemnation. If you forgive, it will lead to forgiveness. If you pardon, it will lead to pardon. So, what we sow, we need to reap. So, earning righteousness and justice through the works, which is the expression of our faith, is essential. And James is keen on his ministry to lead people into covenantal relationship with him. Are you in covenant with your God? Are you in right relationship with your God? If not, these are some of the requirements that we need to be seen in our lives. These 10 imperatives. The thought-provoking verse of sins that are existing in our lives. My dear people of God, continue to meditate upon this. There are few other verses that we need to discuss, and we will move on from verse 13 in the next class. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this blessed time of learning. Thank you, Lord, for revealing to us the necessity of forming ourselves in the righteousness of God. Because, Lord, it is our responsibility to cultivate the truth, to cultivate that faith that you had gifted to us. Yes, Lord, there needs to be an expression that defines the lifestyle of the faith that we belong to. Yes, Lord, we need the expression in our lifestyles by submitting, by resisting, by drawing near to you, by cleansing our hands, by purifying our hearts, by mourning, by weeping, by turning our lightheartedness into gloom, and also to humble before you this evening, Lord. Thank you for revealing to us these in-depth teachings through the letter of James. Continue to minister to us. None of us should be cast away. None of us should stand on that day of judgment. None of us should be counted to be disqualified. Loving Lord, it is the time for us now, the grace that you have revealed to us. In this time of grace, give us the grace to understand, to come back to that revelation, come back to that privilege of being only yours and yours alone in everything that we do. In Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, which calls us to the covenant back, who calls us to the relationship back with him, let your presence be with us now and forevermore. Amen.